And the name of the talk is going to be Governing Bangkok in a Time of Exception Due to the Situation in Thailand. So we try to understand the Bangkok urban regimes and the role of the urban poor since the coup. Why it matter? Because after the coup in 2014, which I can't remember how many coups we have, but I think it's 19 because we're having number 20 as a constitution. Okay. But last year, the junta appointed the new governor of Bangkok. So the governor of Bangkok now is no longer the elected one. I think that's one of the key issues. What's happened after the coup? Because regardless of several modern coups, the coup did not touch upon the structure of local government. But this one, they have the issue with the Bangkok governor. Okay. Show you. This is the Bangkok metropolitan area. Okay. This is Bangkok. So Bangkok is actually number one here. Then the area around Bangkok is what they call extended metropolitan area. So basically the built-up area of Bangkok is larger than the governance structure, the government structure of Bangkok. Okay. And this is the 50 district or kit that I will focus on. The 50 kit, but this is not the 50 municipality. Okay, Bangkok is actually one big municipality with 50 field offices, okay, which is different than the big greater metropolitan structure. Okay, and the structure of my presentation, I cover it, not really a structure. So I talk about the significance of the BMA or the Bangkok government, then the trend of Bangkok. Usually, then what happened after the coup, and then touch upon the issue of the poor. And by the way, I'm not directly affiliated with the Center for Urban Design, so my view doesn't really need to be shared by the center. Okay. So let's start with what is the BMA? Okay, the Bangkok Metropolitan Area. Bangkok Metropolitan Area or the BMA is the only local self-government that has kind of a full 100% urban area, unlike the other province of Thailand. I think it's 76 provinces, right? And usually every province doesn't have 100% urban area. So the municipality is not a 100% area of the whole province, except Bangkok. Okay? And the governor, or actually the precise name is Lord Mayor, not governor, because he's the only one who's not appointed by the central government, unlike the other governor. They say this is the old French structure when they modernized Thailand 100 years ago. Okay, so Bangkok is the only one that has the Lord Mayor for the 100%. So here's my theory. We have in Bangkok, we have the picture in the next slide, but basically we have three layers of government or governance. Okay. First is the city hall level, so Bangkok governor and the Bangkok councillor or the SOGO. We have 50 kids, some kids we have more than one if it's a larger district. Okay. So altogether is 50. Okay, so this is basic, like municipality, right? The mayor and the councillor, both of them separately elected. Okay, then the 50 kid is a director, so it's actually the field office appointed by the governor from the bureaucracy. So this is like a sheriff, actually. Okay, he's the director, and then they have the advisory council, no real power. Just advisor to the kid director. But this is the thing that I think is important. I haven't studied much, but I think this is the important part, which probably fit with the theme of the conference. I would name it the organic level, okay, which is the real practice of governance. Okay, they have several forms. Some are formal, some are informal. Like in England, you have something below the district council, right? Sometimes it's the parish, those kind of thing, right? So some of them is like some of the large slum, they register themselves with the city hall, so they get support. Okay, some of them cooperative with the government, some of them confrontational. Okay, so they organize themselves through struggle with the government, and they form their own identity. So there's different type of this network. Okay, so this is not like the formal structure of city politics that you see from the textbook. So this is very, very localized, but not necessarily local in a sense of neighborhood. It can be issue-oriented. Right? So how to understand this changing of dimension of urban politics, which is not just about the main structure. Okay, and a little bit of context before I move you to the picture is the, well, when you talk about Bangkok, there's three things. One is the trend of urbanization. Everybody knows that Bangkok is a big city. Okay. The second part is Bangkok has a plan, right? It's actually the urbanization thing of Bangkok happened as a result, mainly as a result of national development plans in the 60s. But the land use planning of Bangkok has been in place in the 1990s. So you have a situation of the actual development of Bangkok before the formalization of the plan. So basically, it's a very big city already before you have the land use control, which doesn't really help Bangkok much. Okay, and then you also have the interaction among these three things, right? Urbanization, the absence of the plan, and the structure of the government. So how that interact, okay, not to mention about the national political context of Bangkok, which is the primary city of the developing country. Okay. Let me show you the picture a little bit. Okay, as I said, if you look at it as a three-layer, right, this is what I call the city hall, the city center of Bangkok, right? So as a voter, you vote for Bangkok governor, and you also vote for the councillor. I'm going to talk about this guy, this 61, that I think this is the facto, the real mayor of Bangkok. They were as a real mayor, but it's absent from the structure, okay, because they also were in the real kid. They're the representative of the kid. So the kid, they have the director, right, from the city hall. Right, but the Bangkok governor appoint this. They are the bureaucrat. Okay, this council doesn't have any power, no power in terms of the budget or nothing. They all advisory. Okay, they come from certain group of community, but not representing the whole king. So the king doesn't really function. It's actually the field office of the city hall. Okay, so this is the key one that we all need a lot of research because it depends on the real practice of different cases, right? You might have the temple working on this, you might have different slum working on this, or you might have the large scale of kind of connected through the internet network on certain issues. So how can we conceptualize this part? Okay. This is the structure of politics of Bangkok. The Democrat has been there, the blue one, has been there for more than 10 years. But to have the name the Democrat doesn't really mean that they support democracy. Okay, that's kind of strange a little bit. I mean, they're representative of the people, but they broke who? Okay, well, difficult. Okay, this is a 50K of Bangkok. Okay, so this is a kind of 50 district of Bangkok. But you can see the size different because they have a larger land. Okay, if you understand, this is the maybe not the newest one, but if you see it, right, the green one is more kind of open space. This area is the core area. Okay, this is something in between, fast growing area. This is the area that has more than one Bangkok councillor, meaning basically, this is a fast-growing area, larger population. Okay, so this is a fast-growing area of Bangkok. Okay, see, Bangkok is situated. This is in the middle of Bangkok, the river. Okay, this is another basic number, not really accurate, but as a bureaucracy, okay, you have to have certain number. Right? The total registered population of Bangkok is 5.6. Well, the real number is more than 10 million. Okay, if you talk about this guy population, the town population, and the area around Bangkok, okay, but this is just the areas that the BMA is in charge. So the density, okay, the darker one is more density. Okay, so it's rapid growing at the outskirts, connected to all the extended area of Bangkok. This slide, I want to only show this part. So the modern Bangkok start in terms of administration started in 1985 with the new law. Since then, we have elected governor 9 times already. Okay, and the coup started in 2014. Last year, there was a big corruption case. So the military government removed the governor and appointed the new team. The new team, now the governor was an ex-police who was part of the previous team, but he was not the main one. But he was the main person that has a problem with the poor. So he was the one who in charge of displacement of the poor in the city. So we can be very sure that he's going to continue that policy with what's happening now. Okay. Here is a very colorful picture of when they had the campaign during the democratic time. Okay. They promised to have this BMA green area, okay, and this is kind of very old conventional style of politician of Bangkok. Okay, they visit the community, they have Facebook, they kind of be polite to the people, listening to the issue of the people all the time. Well, a bicycle campaign was a big one. Okay, so every candidate tried to show that they know how to buy. And yeah, conventional way of a big speech. Okay, this is the kind of media. Okay, both the good one and the kind of negative image. Okay. Okay, the result in the last one. The issue here is that, well, even though the Democrat won, right, but it's only 47%. This is the red one. More democratic, relatively poorer in terms of the economic position, but it's 40%. So not much. So the big image that Bangkok is a city of the rich is not really the case. Okay, so if you see the number, it's not that big different. Okay, and the red area, okay, is usually the fast-growing area belong to the poorer team, okay? But the blue one is the one that's been in power for more than 10 years. Okay. It corresponds to the national government election in Bangkok. Okay. The big flood in 2011 set the big kind of a nightmare of Bangkok, which will affect the removal of the poor as well, due to the issue of what I call the flood regime. That you have the issue of the excuse of fixing the flood issue in Bangkok is one of the issues that they're getting into the river and trying to clear up the community along the river. Okay, so I'll talk about it later. But this is the picture of the flood that's coming from the north and the northeast, getting to Bangkok, which Bangkok is a big gateway before getting to the sea. So once this is the main economic area of Thailand, right, they make kind of a big fortified area. So they block the water down to the sea because the governor did not want to have the water running through Bangkok. That's understandable from the city perspective. But because you block the water, now in the floodway to the sea, right? That's why you have more flood around this area. So it's a big issue of uneven development and fairness. This is a rising up land value. I mean, our colleague will have better number, but basically, it's rising up the land value, and the one that rises up more is the one that closer to all the rapid SkyTrain. Okay, so with the new infrastructure, with the new network of SkyTrain, it's increased the number of increased the land value. Let me show you a little bit before the analysis. This is kind of my theory that we have kind of five phases of Bangkok development. Okay, started from the river time in the since they founded Bangkok around 100 years ago. So it was called the Venice of the East. Then we have the motorization around the Second World War. Okay, the Americanization. So you have to replace the canal with the road. Then you have the rise of the suburb. You have rural migrations, and then slum and slum clearance. This is the first slum struggle in the 90s. Then you have a larger group of migrant workers and informal sector in Bangkok. Then you have expressway issue in the 80s, which is more extended metropolitan regions. You have rapid rail service. You have organization of the community struggle against expressway construction. But Bangkok expanded very rapidly. Then you have big flood in the 80s. 2000s, you have SkyTrain and the condominium boom and the new tension between old community and the condominium. Then you have the big flood. And now you have the what I call the return of the river. You have the upscale riverfront development, assetization of the river, or what I call the river beautiful movement. Okay, you try to have to make the river beautiful. It corresponds with tourism and the new upscale land speculation back to the old city center. Okay, so this is the circle of development of Bangkok. Okay, so this is all the big dream of turning the river into upscale land developer, which will affect a lot of community along the river, and that's affected a lot of practices as well. So, part, this is the analysis part. Usually people talk about this. Bangkok is a capitalist city and city of the middle class, right? But what I want to talk about is three things. One is, we talk about governance, right? We come to France, you can't deny the influence of Michel Foucault. So, I want to talk about the governmentality as well. Right, the ideology, the hegemony of urban development. Okay, so that's actually the big level, right? Why and how the middle class can present their own dream as a dream of everyone. Okay, second level is the governance level. Okay, at the kid level, right? How the city actually regulate the pool. Okay, so that's the key to me. It's not just about election, but the real institution that make a deal with the poor in the actual case. And then the network of the poor, the struggle, the informalization of the struggle. Okay? This is the kind of the thing that I really love to talk about. It's the dog park, the dogtopia of Bangkok. This is one of the project that the ex-governor was very proud of. They made a park for the dogs. Okay, so the dog in Bangkok, for the rich people, you can have this public land turned into the dog park. Okay, sponsored by the city hall. Okay, but Bangkok doesn't have the policy for the urban poor in terms of housing, but they provide the park for the dog. Okay, this is the most extreme case that I love to show you about the dream of the middle class, the dogtopia. Okay, so they put a lot of money into it, and you see the representation of the dog. Okay, not the Bangkok usual street dog. Okay, so this is one, but then, well, this is the main issue of the engine of the construction of the middle class dream. Okay, I have 5 slides left. So we have park, bicycle, upscale mass transit, and riverfront is kind of the key grammar of the city beautiful now. Okay, of Bangkok. Yeah, we have zoning law and the green space, right? Green space ratio. Okay. We have a lot of issue of commercialization of public land and estatization of the public land. Make it green, make it clean, make it walkable, make it for bicycle. This is the key for all the regeneration of Bangkok, right? The issue is the government deal with expropriation, especially with the poor community. Okay? But there's no housing office of the city hall. The city hall does not provide housing office, which is different than European city, okay? Bangkok city hall doesn't have a job of giving the people any kind of rental housing or anything, okay? Well, some people say Bangkok is a very working housing market anyway, but there's no responsibility from the commitment from the city hall to deal with the poor in terms of housing, except kicking them out of the land. Okay, they play a big role. Okay, city hall does not provide water, electricity, police, and traffic. This is not the job of the city hall. Okay, they have low accountability. Only flood prevention, garbage, and park, which are people concerned about the city hall. City hall has like 26 responsibility, but other government also provide that. Okay, so they're not kind of the only group that provide. Okay, this is also the big planner, the real planner of Bangkok is actually University Research Unit. They are the partner of urban development. Okay, they got the money from government or developer. So they're the middleman role. It's a big challenge for the university research to play a real role as a planner, because they have to negotiate with the city and with the people, not the city themselves. Okay? And then since the coup, there's a massive clear up of street vendors, communities along the river, rapid wet spot, register motorcycle, taxi, they have the new system. Okay, so the army helped the city hall clearing up this. Okay, it was not possible during the democratic time. Okay. The key issue is actually at the kid, okay? The kid or the district provide the patronage system, okay? Because this is the only big local self-government, so they got the money to the people, okay? And not subjected to the national budget. They have their own budget, okay? And there's a reciprocal relationship between the locality and national party. There's money, and then the councillor actually playing important role as the real municipality mayor, because they can get the money and then negotiate with the governor of Bangkok to deal with different community. That's how they seal the royalty with the community. Okay, not the structure, not the formal structure. They all the politicians who actually work right a man. Okay. The big issue is that the kid has no real deliberative space for collaborative planning. Okay. No leadership from the bureaucratic kid director. Nobody knows who's the kid director. They keep rotating. Okay, there are 50 of them. Okay. No sense of community at the kid level. Like the professor who just talk about it, right? Because people keep moving. So the sense of the kid is not clear. Not like the real neighborhood. So, because people stay in one area and work in another area. So there's no real sense of participatory in the kid level at all. Okay. So network of the poor. Usually when we talk about the poor in Bangkok, not just talking about people who have less money, we have two big issues about the poor. One is the housing issue, the slum people. So they kind of having a big group dealing with it through the concept of human rights agenda and case-based negotiation with the governor and with the government office. But they kind of successful in dealing with each case, but not with the overall understanding of Bangkokian people. They can only deal with each owner of the land, but they cannot deal with all of the middle class people. And the other group of the poor are the group of the informal economy, like street vendor. So they have to deal with the way the governor and the government try to clean them up. The success case, however, are usually based on the cross-caste network. They have to redefine the meaning of the city life in terms of the cultural politics, rather than confrontational politics. This is the key. Okay, when we talk about participatory all the time, it's the issue of, well, you're going to make a strike, but the success case is the case that they have to be able to negotiate with the Bangkokian in general. So they deal with the image of the city, the role, the cultural role of the poor to live in the city, the meaning of the life. So they're not just political economy, not the Marxist sense of strike, not the slum uprising. No, that one is going to be clear up. Okay, so that's the key. University research, as I said, and the media play a crucial role, even though it's really controversial because, well, it's still the middle class dream, but a more sensible one. Okay, so it's, what I say is a regime of desire and image more than the right to the city movement. If in France you talk about the faith, right, the right to the city, this is not what's the case in the poor is cultural politics of being a nice community, living in the big city, right? How to make yourself meaningful in the rapid change, right? How to cooperate with the city. You're not talking about right. Okay, you're talking about, well, the history, some kind of cultural function of your community. Okay. After the coup, right, the flood management, I already talked about, the military trying to expand the area of the floodway, so they kind of clear up the people who live next to the river. Okay. They also have the new, they use the very old law to clear up the land without dealing with the court case. So in 15 days, they can clear out the land based on the military law. So you cannot get, you cannot bring the case to the court if you cannot secure the tenorship of the land. Okay, so they have a lot of gentrification of the town area, the old town area. Another big issue is the 338 spot of street vendor, which is the big chunks of backlog has been cleared up. Okay, around 24,000 cellular affected. Okay, under the military operation, okay, to clear up the city, to have the city as a big border city. Okay, so this is the last slide. I have 5 points to make theoretically as well. First, Bangkok is a contested capital space. It's a capitalist space. Globalized development does not necessarily lead to sustainable and just development. Power and resources in the city are very unequal, as you see from the story. Then this is a big issue. Governance. What is the governance? Does it need to be democratic? Right? Okay. If you take Fukuyama theory, not necessary. So it's a matter of how can you articulate governance and democracy together. You cannot say that talking about governance is 100% democratic. If you look at the case of Thailand, okay. So governance, what does it mean? It's a minimum requirement of making the city government accountable to the people, regardless of the regime. You have to talk about governance in China. You have to talk about governance in authoritarian Thailand as well. You cannot say that let's wait to have democracy first and let's have governance. Not necessary. This is a crucial thing. Okay. So, and in the case of Bangkok, right, democratic city government can be corrupted and unaccountable as well. Sometimes the structure doesn't help, even though you have elected government. So, you might deal with the elitism and participatory government, but not deliberative one. You may have a populist government, right? But that's not the one that can make people live together, because you're going to be ruled by majoritarian all the time, or the logic of capitalism, or sometimes people can be manipulated. So that's a big deal. How can you make people live together? Okay. So deliberation is crucial for good governance and good quality democracy. Okay. Then, as I said, governance has both the level of regulatory, right? You need to be transparent. I mean, you have minimum standard. Make the city accountable to the people. But also, there's another part, as I said, governing without or beyond government level. But you have to talk about communicative level, where you have to talk about unstructured but network of the poor and how that live in the city. So you cannot just talk about what's happening according to the law. You have to talk about how people connect together, the government, governing without government. Okay? And the challenge of the planner is the creation of Bangkok as a negotiative and communicative and reflexive space among several stakeholders rather than the conventional hyper-modern space. What's happening in the city planning theme usually is that you present the best model for the people of the town, right? And then you make people believe that you are the expert, right? The key issue is how can you make Bangkok as a space where everybody can negotiate, okay, and learn from each other, okay? So that's all.